morning, everybody. How are you doing this morning? Before we get started, it's Jody's birthday. So if you guys would sing happy birthday with me, we're going to sing her a happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jody. Happy birthday to you. We love you, Jody.
She's 29, right?
You guys are all hired to be on the worship team. Let's stand and worship this morning.
Ready?
To you alone. spoke the word, you were singing over me. And you've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. Still your love fought for me. And you have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. And you've been so, so kind to me. Deserve it, still you give yourself away. And oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Yeah, yeah. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God.
Say hi to someone you have not said hello.
Oh, that's right. We got one after this. I'm sweating. Woo! Yeah.
Awesome. Hi, I'm Ellie. Good morning, Eureka. 4th of July, how many of you have your fireworks already? There's several booths around town, and a lot of them are going for really good causes. So check them out. Tonight, I think I'm going to be with my brother by Elks Lodge, and I'm going to be helping out a little bit doing that. Okay, I'm doing the announcements today. I think I got a little bit of practice already, so let me see if I do well. But before we start, let me just read this verse of the Bible that the Lord put in my heart. How many of you read the Daily Bread? Awesome. So this is for tomorrow, but I was looking for a significant verse from the Bible to apply to all of us. And now that we have our entire family here, this is perfect. So let me read Ephesians 4, 11 to 16, real quickly. It says, "So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people to work of service so that the body of Christ might be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ." Isn't that beautiful? And I think what I'm going to say in just a few minutes is another service that is among our family here. But first, the church announcement. So check your bulletin for there will be a congregational business meeting following the service today at 11 o'clock, right here. So you can go get your coffee, get your goodies, and come back with the tummy full, and then you'll be happy and sit until, you know, whenever you guys finish, right? Whenever we finish. So, first of all, I want to say thank you to Kenny?
Yeah.
My accent. I've been here 50 years, and I still feel like a foreigner. I'm still learning English. But thanks to Kenny, look inside your brochure, your church brochure, and I'm going to invite Will to come with me because we're partners in crime here. We remember that booth that we had about all the services from the church? Remember that? How many of you were part of that? Okay. So I was walking around getting to know everyone, and all of a sudden I ran into Will. And I found out that he was an electrician. And I said, "Oh, I need an electrician." So we started talking. And I said, "I'm always afraid to go to the Yellow Pages and just hire from the Yellow Pages because you never know who's going to enter my house. I live alone with a cat and a dog. And how much they're going to charge me." And you know what he said, Ellie? What's the first three letters of construction?
Is
that
contractor?
Contractor. Contractor. What is the first?
Three letters. I was told this by a plumber. The first three letters of a contractor is con. So some of them are.
That says a lot, right? So anyway, I said, you know what? There's so many people my age that don't have a honeydew at home anymore. And I used to do the honeydew thing before then, but now I don't get on steps, and I don't climb steps. I don't do things that might break another bone. I was just playing with my dog, and I broke my ankle. But so anyway, this is a FCC blessed list of honeydew skills. Okay? And it says very clear. Do you want to read it for
sure.
us?
Sign up here to join the Blessed List of Home Services. This is a reference list of various home services and will be updated every season. Rates can be at your discretion. Please consider a senior rate for those in fixed budget. Thanks, Ellie and Will. So I got a quick one. We're just here today to collect info to get our summer list together within the next couple of weeks. So a lot of you I've talked to, but if you want to give me more information, I have a table set up out there between the meeting, and we'll collect anybody that wants to fill this out and give it to me. We'll get you on the list. And also, I'm going to start an email list for people that want to email us and get, you know, the list sent to you every time we update it. We're going to update it every season, summer, fall, winter, and spring. And last, if you can recommend somebody, because we don't have a lot of contractors here in the church. We've already pulled some from Lighthouse and Nazarene, and we can always use more. So if you can recommend it to somebody, we're looking for that too.
And it's not to take business from each other. It's for our own family of God to have people around us so we can trust. So we can trust who is getting into our homes. We can trust that they're not going to, you know, give us a price that is not fair. So, and it's not free. I mean, it's just for us to get to know each other. We're working on a pamphlet. Ken is helping us. He's the master of computer here. So praise God for him. He's helping us. And so as soon as we collect the names and all that, and it's not forever. You can always say no. You can always say yes, but not right now. Yes? So it's not, you're not locked into it. It's just to help those who need extra help. And those that don't need extra help, but you would like to, somebody else to do your job. So, okay. So is it clear? Okay, we're going to be by the entrance at the end of the service before you go get your cup of coffee. And if you have any more questions, you can help us. I mean, we can help you answer if we can. One last announcement is no missions class this Saturday until the fall. Okay, so there's a lot of stuff. You know, the worst time of the year is to start things and during the summer. So, you know, we're playing now after COVID, everybody's getting away and all that. So, okay, anything else that I'm forgetting? Okay, I think that's it. We have so much going on in our family here. It's amazing. I thought I was just getting busy with just little things, but praise God. I said, my last years of my life, I want them for you, Lord. And he said, you don't know what you asked for, Ellie. But praise God, because there's no better way to live than serving the Lord. And, you know, I just want to see a hand of all my honeydews that are willing to participate. Let's see. Look around. Look at all the honeydews that we have. And the honeydews that don't know yet, talk to us. Okay? We might convince you to be part of it. Okay. God bless you all, and let's continue worshiping the Lord. Thank you.
If you would stand and sing this hymn with us, we're going to sing hymn number 429.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray.
Side by side.
they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, it's time for the children to get to go next door to the Cove. So children fifth grade and below, Andrew's going to be leading you there. So come on over to the door here and we'll say a prayer before you go. Whoa, look at them all. All right, let's pray for the children and their leaders as they go. Father, thank you for these children. Thank you for the parents that have brought them. Thank you for the leaders that are going to teach them your truths. May they show them your love and your truth today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So now let us pray. God, you are our shepherd. You have all that we need. You let us rest in green meadows. You lead us beside peaceful streams. You renew our strength. You guide us along our paths, bringing honor to your name. We have come to worship you today. We come not as perfect people. No, we are all imperfect. We are all in need of daily grace. We praise you today that we can revel in the complete forgiveness and acceptance that you, Father, grant us in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you especially this weekend and next week as we celebrate this country in which we live. We thank you for our city. We thank you for our church, for those who worship here, for those who can serve you here. We pray for those among us who are suffering loss, illness, loneliness, disappointment. Thank you that you can meet each of us in our need. Thank you for those who are serving you as missionaries, your ambassadors here and around the world. Protect and empower them. We pray for TLC camps starting in about a week. May your love be shown. May your truth be told in powerful ways. We pray for open hearts, receptive hearts, repentant hearts among the campers. We pray, God, for a harvest. And now we pray that your words would come through Ali as he speaks, and that our hearts would be open to what you want to say to each one of us. You are truly a good, good Father. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is going to be from the book of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 22 through 33, if you'd like to follow along. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost!" they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You have little faith," he said. "Why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down, Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." God bless the reading of his word this morning.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege once again of speaking to your people. God, it's a strange time that we live in now, and so we pray that you would speak to our hearts. Hide the speaker, that you will be heard, that you will be glorified. God, we pray, God, that somebody here would hear about Jesus Christ and in doing so would make a decision to surrender their heart to Christ. And we ask these things in the precious and exalted name of Christ. They all said, amen, amen, amen. I have the privilege today, a unique privilege today, of not only speaking to you, but then after this, I get to moderate the meeting, the business meeting, which is kind of weird. It's kind of like preaching and then moderate. So anyway, I'm going to work with that. In my speaking capacity here as your pastor, one of your pastors, I will be speaking as God has led me from this particular passage. Now, some of you already know this passage. You already know this story. But when I move over to the other side after the service and then speak to you as the moderator for the meeting, I'm still in my pastoral role, but I'm more of a moderator for the business meeting. So that's a whole different take. So just thought I'd put that out to you. Have you ever found yourself sinking under the waves of worry and fear? Even though you are a believer, you know Jesus and all of that, you come to church, why do you think it's so easy to lose sight when the storms of your life are raging? What fears or beliefs prevent you from fully surrendering to what we would say is the sovereignty of God? Because, ladies and gentlemen, what it really comes down to, brothers and sisters, it's not rocket science here. What it really comes down to is how much are you and I willing to say, yes, Jesus, you are the one who is in control of everything. And how much are we willing to own that and say, yes, even in the turbulent times of my life, God, I trust you. Because that's what's happening here in this story. What's interesting to me, it just hit me. I was just sitting there. I was thinking, wait a minute. It was barely probably 5-6 months earlier that there was a boat incident. Jesus was in the boat with the disciples and their storm comes up and they're asleep. Jesus is asleep and they wake him up and, don't you care? And you know the story. Jesus wakes up and he kind of goes over and says, peace be still. Okay. Leave me alone. They had forgotten that Jesus was on the boat with them. They had forgotten. Less than 6 months later, a situation comes up again on the Sea of Galilee with the boat. Less than 6 months later, they've seen God do some powerful things. In fact, in this story, if you back up a little bit, you see that Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist, has been beheaded. Then they go away and Jesus feasts the 5,000. I got to believe that he was kind of dealing with the fact that John the Baptist had been killed. It wasn't a surprise to him because he's fully God and fully man. He would have that sense of empathy. Feast of 5,000. And then Jesus says, go get on the boat. And then all of a sudden, he says, I'll join you later. All of a sudden, you find out that the boat is going along and it's out there for a while. And the disciples are in trouble again in a boat event. And they've forgotten. Peter has forgotten that the same God that fed the 5,000 The same God that's been healing folks, that's been doing all this other ministry, less than 6 months later, it's the same God now that's speaking to them. And the issue always comes down to what we struggle with today, brothers and sisters. Where is your faith? It sounds so simple. You just have to have faith. But yet it is the thing that I believe that most of us will miss because we're looking for answers in all the wrong places. Where is your faith? And I would submit to you, just do a test on a scale of 1 to 10. How would you rate your level of surrender to God's sovereignty in your personal life? On a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate God's sovereignty? That is God's full authority and control in your life. Not your control, but God's control. With your family, with your career, with your business. I believe that one of the primary reasons that this is a struggle, this whole faith thing, it's because the people, you and I, have forgotten, and sometimes we forget, like the disciples did, who is it that has sovereign control over nature, over our lives, over everything? We forget. That the same God that spoke into dust and dust became a living being, that God is the God who has control over my life. The same God that parted the Red Sea and allowed the children of Israel to go through is the same God that would still the waters, the troubled waters of our own lives. You see, you got to go back to remember, who is it that really is the person that has ultimate authority? Who is it that really runs our life? If you think that you have control, ma'am, sir, I assure you, you are wrong. You and I don't have control. We think we have control. One of the big illusions of our time is that we think we control our lives, and we don't. You make decisions, true enough, of which you are accountable and responsible. But the ultimate outcome is a sovereign God who sits high and looks low. He's a sovereign God who sees and knows. It's that God that I appeal to when things kind of unravel, when things become turbulent and crazy. It's that God. So what we have to do is we have to kind of reframe the way we think about who this is, who this God is, because what will happen is what exactly happened with Peter. Water is they're out there ways in the boat. Jesus says, get in the boat, I'll join you. They're out there in the boat. The water is rough. The waves are rocking. Years ago, I was on a boat with my grands when they were little bitty grands, Karen, and we were down in Tahoe area. Something you could rent a boat and go out. You pay a fee and you rent a boat and you go out. And I'd never done anything with boating, but I paid the money to go out. This is an 18 footer or 21 footer. I don't know. It looked like a It looked pretty easy peasy. I'm an engineer, right? So it's like, it can't be that hard. Get on the boat. My family, all of us, we get out there on the boat. They give you this quick five-minute kind of lesson. Do this, do this, do this. Here's the control. Here's how you do this. Here's how you steer. Here's how you stop. Got it. Get on the boat. Throttle it up. And we're going out there. We're drifting out there. And we're looking pretty good. I got this. Getting some distance between where we were launched from, and now it's looking like it's all water, and it's like the pier is getting smaller and smaller. And I noticed something. I all of a sudden, the boat starts vibrating like the bottom is going to fall off of it. It's boom, 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 boom. My wife, Kiki, and the kids, they're screaming and hollering. They're in fear. because it looks like the boat is going to blow up or capsize or something. And I'm saying, hey, we got this. We got it. And it's starting to kind of frighten me a little bit because nothing is happening except that this horrendous noise under the boat. Boom, 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 boom. Karen, at this time, she's screaming at the top of her voice, go back. Go back. You can go out here by yourself. Go back. So after I finally gave in, I said, okay, let me turn around. I don't know. I'll just turn the thing around. And we went back. Get back. And everybody's mad at Dad. I go back to the guy, and he says, hey, I was just going to call you and let you know that, the weather changed. And so it's getting a little bit weird out there now. So we're asking all the boats are coming in. You were the last one. I said, oh, okay. Later on, I found out that part of the problem was operator error. That what you have to do when you go out on a boat, you have to plane the boat, because if you have it halfway plane, you get this weird dynamic where the waves are hitting the bottom of the boat and it's not going to be a pleasant ride. But if you throttle it up, the boat kind of pulls up a little bit and you're able to ride smooth in. Didn't know that. I'm going to say this phrase more than once, and you'll hear me say it. Faith floats, fear flounders. Fix your focus on Jesus. If you want to take something away from today's message, that's it. Faith floats, fear flounders or falters or whatever word you want to use. Fix your focus on Jesus. The problem with Peter is he was doing okay when he stepped off, because the Lord said, yeah, he said, well, if it's you, because they thought it was a ghost. I think the Greek is phantasma. Phantasma, as you can imagine, the word is phantom. We get our word phantom. So it was this kind of apparition, kind of passing by. And it's kind of looks like Jesus. I don't know. It looks like something else. I don't know what it is. A boogeyman. I don't know what it is. But they were afraid. They were afraid. 6 months later, they're still afraid. They still don't know. And maybe I'm judging them too much, because maybe you and I would have been in that situation where we would say, oh, I don't know what that is. I don't know. But then Peter says, if it's really you, Jesus, if it's really you, then call me out there. I don't think he was challenging Jesus. I think in his mind he was saying, okay, I got it, it's you, but then I want to come to you. He steps out. He's doing fine. He steps out. And he's coming to Jesus. And suddenly things change. Why did things change? Why did they change? Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. So he's moving toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, watch this. When he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Save me, Lord. 6 months later, why are you afraid? If it's Jesus that's calling you out, you know where I'm going with this. If it's Jesus that's calling you out, step out of the boat and keep the focus on Jesus. The reason why some of us are so in this weird place today, in this political, charged, chaotic, uncertain, weird environment, is because we've taken our focus off of Jesus. We've stopped looking at Jesus, and we've started listening and looking at the pundits and everything else that's going on, and that's informing us, and we think we got the answer to life's chaos. And I got to tell you, that's wrong. It's not the answer. that the sovereign God, the same God who created this world, this universe, that God is the one that's really in control. Come on, church, you know I'm right on that. You know I'm right on that. I don't care what happens, who's on the, in charge, whether it's the right side of the aisle or the left side of the aisle, whatever camp you're in, the bottom line is our God is sovereign and he is in control. And once you lock that into your head, you can say, oh, okay, faith floats, fear flounders, fix my focus on Jesus. That's what we have to be about. The issue is always faith, because in chapter 13, verse 58, Jesus makes an interesting comment. He says, and he did, no, Jesus doesn't say this, but the writer in Matthew says this, and he did not do many miracles because of their lack of faith. You see, the issue is always faith. Do you have faith? Remember the story in Luke, I think it's Luke 18, about the persistent widow that keeps bothering. Finally, she bothers the judge until she gets justice, gets what she wants. Right at the very end of that, you ever notice what's right at the end of that? When the Son of Man returns to earth, will he find faith? It's like this random statement. Out of all this nice story about this widow that keeps knocking on the door, and then at the very end, when the Son of Man returns, when Jesus comes back, will he find faith? You see, that's what it's really about. I think it's always the faith issue. Do you have faith? Why, Pastor? Because we know already that without faith, it is impossible to please God. God is pleased when we act on faith, when we trust him, when we depend on him, when we stop trying to control our own lives. God is pleased with that. As long as you're in the driver's seat and you think you can run the show, then when things get turbulent and crazy and the boat starts doing all kind of weird things, it's up to you. It's up to you to figure it out. And guess what? Most of us will fail miserably. Michael Milton, a professor of pastoral theology at the Reformed Theological Seminary, made this comment. He says, the storms of life, quote, the storms of life refer to that place in between miracles of yesterday and the promises of tomorrow, those seasons of trial and even doubt that come to all of us at some points in our lives. The storms of life refer to that space, that place in between the miracles of yesterday and the promises of tomorrow. Those seasons of trial and even doubt that come to all of us at some points in our lives. Looking at verse 22 and 24, Jesus sends his disciples ahead. Remember in the other story in Matthew earlier, 6 months earlier, Jesus is getting in the boat with them. In this part of the story, Jesus is not getting in the boat. He sends them ahead. And I thought about this. I said, okay, Jesus didn't get in the boat, so there was something he was up to here. Obviously, he was going to do something with this whole experience. Yes, he needed some time to go up the mountain, be by himself. And by the way, that going up the mountain kind of reminds us a little bit of Moses going up Mount Sinai. He goes up the mountain, get away. The disciples go forward. And all of a sudden, it's like they're in trouble. They're way out there now, and they're in trouble. And Jesus, I think Mark says, he was passing by. Matthew doesn't say that. But Mark makes this comment that Jesus was passing by. Kind of remind you of the story in Exodus about where God passes by. You see, I don't believe all this is by accident. I think there's something that God was doing, kind of teaching the disciples that he is sovereign and that all they have to do is surrender to his sovereignty in everything. Not just when you get your belly full. Not just when you have everything else, there's enough money. Not just when all the relationships are right. Not just when your business is thriving and doing right. Not when the church is doing fine and everything, there are no schisms. But he is sovereign all the time. And once we get that in our heads, it's a game changer. It's a game changer. And especially, it's a game changer in these times. Remember the story about, I don't know if you know, it's European folklore, Henny Penny. Anybody know Henny Penny? Chicken Little. Remember that story? You know the story. It's a grand story of misinterpretation, right? Chicken Little, you know. Some of you are going, Chicken Little, what are you talking about? Acorn falls on his head, and he thinks that the sky is falling. So he runs off, and he tells everybody, the sky is falling. And he actually rallies other people to believe the same thing. And so they're scurrying around, the sky is falling. And it was just a little acorn that happened to just drop on his knucklehead. The same thing happens with us. Sometimes we have these incidents in life that kind of cause us to panic. Oh, did you watch the debates? Yes, right. I went there. And you freak out, you panic, and everybody is we're doomed. Faith floats. Fear flounders. Fix your focus on Jesus. Amen. Say it.
Faith floats. Fear flounders. Fix your focus on Jesus.
There you go. Amen. Right? Is that? I mean, we could do the benediction now and close it out. That's it. The point is that we're given to fear over faith, and sometimes we forget that God. What God has already done in our lives. See, one of the things I think is key, and which I see it with the disciples, is they had forgotten. And we forget too sometimes that God has already demonstrated. God has a track record already with us where he's demonstrated that he will come through. He may not come through exactly when we want him to come through, but he will come through. Right? Yeah, you pray, nothing wrong with praying, but at the end of the night, you say, God, you're sovereign, and I trust you. I'm trusting you for the outcome. My prayer a lot of times now, as I've gotten at this stage of life, is saying, God, you already know. I say, God, you already know. So I'm just doing this more or less for me. I'm not trying to convince you of anything, because you are sovereign. You already know. And so I trust you for the outcome. Whatever that is. Give me the wisdom to be able to deal with the outcome as you deem it, not as I want it. See, I don't want anything for me that God doesn't want for me. I only want what God wants for me. It took me years to get to that place. Years. It took me 20 years to get to that place because I always thought prayers was about what I want. He's the genie God. You rub the genie. You know, poof, things happen. And God is saying, no, it's about faith and trust in a sovereign God who already knows the outcome. You know that's right, church. He saw the wind, and when he saw the wind, it threw him off. Because faith requires that we keep our focus on Jesus. Fear comes when we become distracted over our circumstances and lose our focus. And that's what happens with fear. You lose your focus because you get distracted. When Peter looked down, instead of looking at Jesus, he was distracted. How often do we do that, each of us? We're going through life and something happens. Something happens that we didn't anticipate happening. And all of a sudden we go into panic mode. And some of us got that stuff going on where we just, well, I got to fix this. I'm in charge of this. I got this mess. I got to fix it. I just got to hunker down and fix it. Well, you keep hunkering down. The reality is you are not in control. Why? Say it.
Faith
That's it. Okay, so within this story, I believe that there is the message of the gospel there. And you already know where this is going. Peter cries out for Jesus to help. And immediately, Jesus reaches out to save him. That's a picture of salvation. You see, we cry out. We surrender. And when we surrender, we're saying to God, God, I can't control my life. I've tried for 20, 30, 40 years. I cannot control my life. But you can. And the fact that I've been trying to control my life simply undergirds the reality that I am a sinner in need of your grace. And that's the bottom line. I wish I could pretty it up, make it sound better, but we're all sinners. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's not one person that is perfect that can say, I got it together. We're all sinners. And the real question this morning is, are you going to surrender to Jesus when he says, come? Are you going to say yes and trust him? Now, that requires that you acknowledge where you're at. You know, kind of going in one of those stores, I've said this before, I go into a mall, I have no idea where I'm going. I look for that kiosk where it says, has a picture of the mall, and it says, you are here. See, once you know where you're at, then you can figure out where you're at. So what I want to ask you is, do you know where you're at? Are you just showing up for church? Can I meddle a little bit? I'm going to do it anyway. But so here's the thing. Churches are full of people. Some churches have a lot of people. They're coming out of the woodwork. But are the people really, really, are they in church and the church is really in them? Is it something real that they can take away, and that when they're away from the church house, some kind of way, Jesus is still manifesting himself in so many different ways. The Spirit of God is still operating because they understand that it's really about surrendering to the sovereignty of God, because faith floats, fear flounders, fix your focus on Jesus is the bottom line. Or are they just folk that kind of just check the box? Yep, I was there. Got 4 Sundays in a row. I'm doing pretty good. It has to be about, do I have a relationship with Jesus? Do I really have a relationship with Jesus? I'm going to fast forward because I want to close us. And I just want to say take a look at that story when you get a chance. But at the end of the story, Jesus says, you of little faith, verse 31, why did you doubt? And when they climbed into the boat, so Jesus got into the boat with them, the wind died down. So Jesus' presence brought the shalom, brought the peace. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Now, I find that really interesting because So you weren't convinced all the other times? All the other miracles, all the times, and today now, when Peter steps out of the boat and does this kind of stroll on the beach, you now are convinced that he is the Son of God? Let us not penalize Peter too much. Because sometimes for some of us, listen to this, we will need to walk out there in turbulent waters. We will need the waves to start kind of getting ready to take us down before we realize that we are not in control. And once we realize we're not in control, then we just have to cry out, not in fear, but cry out in faith. God, I trust you. I don't know where this is going, but I trust you. So, how do I get there? Regular prayer is key. You got to be a praying person. If you're not a praying person and you're a believer, something is wrong. Reading and meditating the Word, you got to be in the Word. That's fundamental. It's like trying to make a cake and you don't have the flour. Some of the ingredients are missing. You got to have certain ingredients that make it work. You got to engage in some sort of spiritual discipline. You got to belong to some sort of faith community. can't do as the writer in Hebrews says. You can't just neglect the gathering together. You got to figure that out. Now, do we have to be at church every single Sunday? I'm not going to go there and make it legalistic. But you got to have some sense of consistency of being with the people of God who have faith, who understand that to do this work well, to be able to navigate these troubled waters that we live in, is you've got to have a sense that I've surrendered completely to the sovereignty of God over everything. So you got to be with people that think like that. If you're not with people that think like that, then it's a wash. And then you've got to recall the times that you've seen that God is operating already, because God has a track record, then you obey what you already know. You already know that God has come through, and so you just have to obey that. Go back and look at the scriptures. Where, let me remember. I remember God did such and such a thing. I remember, and you just go back and you obey what you know. Paul writes to Romans, one of the most powerful statements in that book that I believe, in the book of Romans, that captures this whole thing, what it means to trust Jesus. And it's in Romans 10, 9 and 10. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, that's a declaration of sovereignty. Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, you're made right, and it's with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. In essence, that's it. That's what it comes down to. If you want to be this person with of surrendered faith and trust, you have surrendered to the sovereignty of God in your life, then it starts with this declaration of saying, God, you're real. You're real. You're sitting on the throne of my heart, and it's real. It's real. If you're not sure, there's no shame. You simply say, okay, God, I'm not sure. So I'm going to give you a chance before we close this. I want to give you a chance. If you're not sure, I'm not going to ask you to come up. But if you want to come up, I'll pray with you. We'll have people up here that can pray. I think there's two or three people that would be willing to pray. But I would not leave this service if you're not absolutely sure that when the turbulence comes, when it gets very, very crazy out there, you can call on a Jesus. You can call on a Jesus that's real in your heart. And you're able to keep your focus on that Jesus because you know him. Not just know about him, but you know him. But my grandmother knows him. My uncle knows him. No, do you know him? But my kids are all said, do you know him? But I was raised in the church. But do you know him? But I give money to the church. But do you know him? Makes a difference. If you're sitting out there today and there's somebody that's sitting out there, maybe, maybe not, and you need to make a different decision so that you can say that, yes, I want to move in this place of trusting God, believing that God will move and do things even in the most turbulent life, but I need to know him first, and I need to do that, and I want to do that right now. You can do that. Maybe you're already a believer, but you just need to kind of firm up this reality that, hey, I really need to go back and trust what it means to surrender to the sovereignty of God in my life because I haven't been doing it. I haven't been surrendering, and I want to do that. So you can come. You can come right now. You can put your hand up if you don't want to come up here, and I'll just pray for you right where you're at. But my prayer people, come on up here. Anybody that's a prayer person, come on up here. Quickly, hurry. If you don't know Christ, this is your chance. You can come up and you say, yes, I need to know Christ because I need to surrender my heart first. Because if I'm trying to surrender to the sovereignty, I got to surrender to my heart first, to Jesus Christ. I confess with my mouth, believe in my heart. Is there one? Okay, I'm turning the page. you're already a believer, but you have not been living the life of a surrendered to the sovereignty of the God kind of life. You can stand up. You can come forward. We can pray with you. Is there one? You know, the devil is always, no, I'm not going to be the only one. Oh, no, I'm not going up. Oh, not me, not me, not me. Amen, brother, amen. Amen. Were you coming for just to have prayer?
Because I know that daily I don't do everything that I could do in order to live the life of the mission.
Amen, amen. Pray with that sister, that brother. Anybody else? I know we're a little bit longer, but I don't want to rush this. You cannot have a life that surrendered to the sovereignty of God if you don't know God. And if you do know him, then you're not living obediently to what it means to keep the focus on, because you're distracted by politics, you're distracted by everything else. You're distracted, and if you're distracted, you don't have your mind on Jesus. Anybody else? You want prayer? Amen. Come on down. Come on down. Praise God. Come on down. This is no shame. This is, we're people of God. We love each other. We recognize that we're not perfect. Come on down. Young folks, you're not excluded from this either. Lord, I need to get my life right. I need to get my life together, but I cannot do it until I recognize that you are sovereign first. You're sovereign over my heart. You know, you see. Some of us are sinking in the sea of anxiety over finances. Some of us are sinking in the sea of emotional distress over a broken relationship. Some of us are sinking in a sea of uncertainty because of a medical exam. Some of us have all kinds of circumstances and stuff. We're sinking. We're sinking, and we know we're sinking, and we're too prideful to even admit that we're sinking. But all you have to do is get your focus back on Jesus. Faith floats, fear flounders. Fix the focus on Jesus. That's what we're looking for. I know somebody is saying, oh, it's taking too long. You have to just be patient. I spent 20 years of my life trying to run my life. And I wasted 20 years because I thought I could control my life. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Well, thank you. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your willingness to go a little bit longer. Worship team, get ready.
Please stand and join us as we sing hymn number 56.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who is his life an atonement for sin, and open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, the moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He hath taught us, great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done.
I gotta request. Can you do that one piece there, and you guys don't sing, and let them sing that part where it says, you know, that one refrain?
Yes.
Can we do that? You can be mad at me if you want to, but you're going to have to love me anyway. I want you to sing it like you really mean it, because sometimes you just kind of go through the motions. I've done that in a song where I just went through the motions because I had to go somewhere. Let's sing it like we really like. Let's go start right there. You guys don't sing, though. Let them sing. Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice. Praise. Should do our benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance and give you peace. Amen. 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 I love you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the people